Welcome to my talk regarding capacity building and open source communities to realize mobile and secure applications for improving public health using satellite-based navigation systems. Some months ago, I met Professor Engelbert Niehaus, who told me about his idea of a technical system allowing to mitigate health risks, which he presented at last year's ATSEX FUI conference. I never heard of this before, but I was fascinated of it immediately, and the idea was born to try to connect this project with our computer science classes. As we are new in the ATSEX FUI community, let me say a few words about our university and myself before I'll recapitulate the mentioned proposal of last year's ATSEX FUI workshop. Then I'll discuss what we will need for capacity building and how the project matches our study courses in computer science. My name is Herbert Thielen. I studied electrical engineering at the universities in Aachen and Munich, but early oriented towards IT systems in general and software development for real-time and embedded systems in special. For some years I was developing and testing software for GSM and UMTS base stations before I became a lecturer at the University of Applied Sciences in Worms, which is a small but quite historic town at River Rhine in Germany. My current lectures at the Fachhochschule Worms are in the area of local area networks, network security, software testing, system administration and script programming, and I'm supervising a module directed to exercising teamwork in software development. The Fachhochschule Worms is a small university with about 3,300 students. About 20% of them are taking some course in the Faculty of Computer Sciences. I myself have my lectures in the bachelor course Angewandte Informatik, that is Applied Computer Sciences. Later I'm also referring to our master course Mobile Computing, which is a consecutive course to the Applied Computer Sciences bachelor course. When I got to know the proposal of Engelbert Niehaus a few months ago, I was fascinated of it immediately, as I mentioned already. His talk was about public health response and crowdsourcing with the objective to apply low-cost technology for ecotoxicological monitoring with spatial decision support. To accomplish this, he proposed to establish a low-cost tracking framework to collect the environmental data in a crowdsourcing approach, which is shown in the next slide. The slides with blue background are original slides of Engelbert Niehaus' presentation. Low cost can be achieved by using smartphones, which are usually equipped with GPS receivers. Thus, it's relatively easy to provide a pseudo measurement device based on the GPS location and data which is retrieved from an online service. After saving the data in the smartphone, also an offline usage is possible. Low cost can also be supported by developing the software as open source by an open community. By using this software, the open community again is enabled to provide and access environmental data and information as open content, which may ultimately support a risk identification and response cycle to improve the public health in different aspects. What do we need to support capacity building in the area of this project? As Engelbert Niehaus showed in his talk, a major contribution to capacity building can be achieved by an open community approach, that is software development according to the open source model and providing information as open content. Everybody involved needs to contribute only small parts, but can access the whole existing data respectively software. Because the new parts are again open source, the available knowledge and software features are growing constantly. In the area of open source software, many high-quality development environments are available. Over the last years, many organizations as the GNU organization, the Apache Foundation or the Open Source Initiative made valuable contributions to this approach. Nevertheless, for any project, an initial feature set must be developed by individual persons or small teams, or must be donated by companies to the open source community. So to attract other developers, we surely need a first proof of concept that is a visible solution, though it still may be far away from being usable. To keep the know-how on a constantly high level and to avoid the risk of starvation in the project, a permanent core development team is surely highly appreciated. Later, even project forks are no evil. They stay open source and derivatives can be merged back. But what about the quality aspects of such an open community project? Not only the software needs to be high quality, but also the data which is collected by the open community must be trustworthy. So we do need some quality assurance in the process, as Engelbert Niehaus mentioned already last year. The technical basements for open content are mainly available and well known, for example usage licenses like the Creative Commons licenses and different collaboration platforms like MediaWiki, which is the technical platform of Wikimedia, and this project also gained much experience regarding quality assurance in a project with a huge number of contributors. For our project we surely need a suitable database according to the type of data collected, but for quality assurance aspects we also need to have some means to identify the data contributors and to compare the submitted data with the history, so that there is a fallback option in case of doubts. To collect and submit data, contributors need an easy-to-use application, but usability often is contradictory to security. This must be balanced. The motivation can be enhanced greatly by including some community aspects. Actually, two different applications to provide open content are required. One mobile application which can be used offline to collect the data and online to submit the data, while quality assurance is supported better by a web interface to the database. Well, that sounds quite complex. May this project match our computer science courses? To support the project, we need the required technical skills. Do our students learn them in our computer science courses? I'm pretty sure yes, and I'll show why I'm convinced of this. But even if they can support the project, will they want to get involved in this project? How can we attract them? There are some ideas I'll show shortly. And finally, if they can and want, do they have the time to do it? To develop software of high quality, you need quite some time. And the young students don't yet have much experience, but I think even this can be solved. This diagram gives an overview of the study program in our bachelor course Applied Computer Science. The rows from bottom to top show the 7 semesters required. Each little square corresponds to one single module, here always with a workload corresponding to 5 credit points. The green and white blocks provide options of setting an individual focus in the study program. The other modules shown here are mandatory for everybody. In the 6th and 7th semester, there are no regular modules anymore, but a larger team-oriented project, a practice term and the bachelor thesis. With the orange ovals, I have marked the modules which can immediately service the project. To focus their study, the students may select one of 3 areas. I've shown here the focus software construction and the focus cloud and internet, both surrounded by green rectangles. From each focus area, the students have to take 6 out of 9 available modules. Additionally, they have to take 4 further modules, either from the remaining focus modules or from some complementary modules. Again, I've marked with the orange ovals those modules which can immediately service the project. Without going into every detail, the necessary skills to master such a software development project are delivered during the study course. General software development skills like requirements engineering, software engineering, programming, testing or databases, and, partly dependent on the selected focus, skills which provide special benefit to our project. Network technologies including network security, web applications, for example HTML and CSS, mobile application development, usability and cryptography. The master course Mobile Computing, which provides a consecutive study course to the graduates of the bachelor course Applied Computer Science, is focused, as the name says, on mobile computing, so it's perfectly matching the required skills in our project. The skill status of our students seems to be fine, at least if they learned all things we tried to teach them in the different modules. But what about the students' interest, their motivation? How can we attract the students' attention for this kind of project? It may seem to be not much fun to develop this system, it's not a game. But does everything have to be a game? It's no illusion, it's a real-world example, it's helpful to real-living people and it's technically challenging. So if the students think a little bit about it, I believe they may like it. The students may also estimate the project to be too complicated and thus somewhat frustrating. But here we can take countermeasures by introducing parts of the project as real-world examples in different modules and thus introducing it step by step, which reduces the supposed complexity. Finally, if we mastered the do they can and the do they want question, when should they do it? The assumption, at least in politics, is that one credit point in the European Credit Transfer System, ECTS, corresponds to 25 to 30 hours workload of the students. So one of our usual modules, which has 5 credit points, can generate a workload of about 125 to 150 hours. To be honest, if we really demand this as a medial value, the students will complain very hard. Anyway, even 150 hours are short for software development if it's done in teams. But we do have some larger modules in the study courses, which are focused on projects by design. The team-oriented software project in the bachelor course, the bachelor thesis, the system development project in the master course and the master thesis. These larger modules are predestined to support our project directly. The sketched project not only matches our study courses in the sense that the study courses, respectively our students, can support the project, it's also the other way around. We have some educational objectives and those are supported by the project too. Firstly, as mentioned earlier, the project can be used as real-world example in the modules where we have to deliver the skills, and if we have this project, we can go into detail if required. Secondly, the study shall support the students' personal development and raise their social skills. What's more suitable than to practice teamwork, maybe worldwide, and to empower others for self-help? Referring to the motivation question discussed earlier, in the last year's master course, students themselves proposed, among others, 2 projects in the large area quantified self and started to realize them in small teams. The first is dedicated to monitoring blood glucose values, which might be helpful for patients suffering diabetes mellitus. The other project plans to realize a rescue pass, which shall provide access to personal data which can be essential in emergencies, for example regarding allergies, blood group, etc. Both projects show that the students indeed can be motivated to this type of project, though the projects are less complex than what we discussed earlier. While these smaller projects are independent, the bigger project may direct the different activities to one common goal. So what's the conclusion now? As I discussed, all parties involved would benefit from the connection of the 86 FUI software target with the practice works in our bachelor and master courses. People all over the world would get an open source software system for ecotoxicological monitoring to mitigate risks and support health. The students would get challenging and motivating tasks in a real-life project, and our university would get, hopefully, higher motivated students. In a final picture, the students on the left may work on different projects of one big technology framework. The bachelor students may focus on the server-side applications and the database, that's on the bottom of the picture, while the master students may focus on the mobile application parts in the upper left. This mobile application can be used by people all over the world to get GPS-supported risk information regarding their local environment and to contribute to the available data. Some organization may use the server-side applications for quality assurance of the data and the whole framework for supporting health. Now, what are the next steps to realize this big picture? Firstly, we have to convince a student to realize an initial version, for example in his bachelor or master thesis, which later can be used in follow-up projects. The first steps are somewhat slow and boring for a team, so a single person start may suit better. Then, as I proposed to introduce the projects by examples during the study, we have to involve other lecturers, hopefully not too hard to do. When the software has some volume already, we can involve the public. Graduates could continue to work at the project and they could be disseminators and infect others with this idea. Finally, when we have a working software, we'll go the usual hard way of rolling it out, that is, field tests, providing training material, etc., etc. Thank you for your attention, and I'm looking forward to your questions and the discussion.